What's going on? Welcome back to the channel. Big Dope Gotta Eat, Fantasy Football and Fitness. We are gonna continue on the mock draft journey. Before I get into the video, make sure you're following me on all my social medias. That's IG, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter. Now I have two Twitters, one's my personal, one's for fantasy football. Everything is linked below. Please go do that. Give this video a thumbs up already. I know you didn't watch shit yet, but go give it a thumbs up. Last week, Nicholas and I did the first round of a 2017 fantasy football mock draft, 12 teams, half point PPR. Today we're gonna get into round two. I'm just gonna be doing this by myself. I'm not sure where Nick is, but I'm gonna keep it rolling. I'm gonna keep the train steaming along. Round two. Another 12 teams, another 12 picks. I also wanted to ask something before I got into this video. I do the YouTube fantasy football because, mainly because, well, I wanted to be able to obviously do the whole video thing, kind of show off the, not my personality, but give you guys more of a look as to who I am as a person, you know, and kind of give it more flavor. If I were to just strictly go podcast, you know, it would fall into, that's such a saturated market, I guess you could say. There's a million people doing the fantasy football podcast, a million people doing, you know, like blogging about fantasy football, so it's impossible to really get yourself out there. And I feel like the YouTube fantasy football niche is not very saturated yet. There's a couple big name players, obviously, but I feel like this is a better way for me to be able to get across to you guys. But I've been thinking recently that I kind of want to do podcast, and I don't know, I want your guys' feedback on this. Would you guys prefer me do a podcast of this, or would you, I could do the video and then save it as an audio file as well and then upload it as a podcast. Like, would you want both versions of this? Would you want just strictly a podcast? I know it's a lot easier to take in the information podcast, so you can do it while you're commuting. A lot of the times, you know, you can't watch YouTube at work, you can't watch YouTube on your commute. I mean, you can, but you're wasting a hell of a lot of storage on your phone and all that shit, so I wanted your feedback before I start doing the whole podcast thing. But I haven't really looked into it much, but I think it is pretty easy just to save this as a file, as an audio file, and then upload it as a podcast. But it would take a little extra editing because I have to edit some things out, but it's a lot easier as a podcast because, you know, you could just read your notes and keep your head down the whole time. But that's not really what I wanted to give to this channel. That's the reason why I do the YouTube. That's the reason why I do it this way. But let me know your thoughts. Leave a comment down below. And let's get this biatch started. Whew, I'm out of breath. Now I'm like sweating and spinning. Yeah. Play the music. So let's talk some fantasy foosball 2017. Excuse me if I'm looking down at my notes every once in a while. I can't always keep eye contact with y'all. You're all so good looking, I don't want to make it weird. So I'm going to be looking down at my notes because I have a lot of notes written down, so excuse me for that. Last week, we did the first round. Let's run through the first 12 picks. We had Le'Veon Bell, David Johnson, Antonio Brown, Ezekiel Elliott, Julio Jones, Odell Beckham, Jordy Nelson, Mike Evans, number 9, LeSean McCoy, number 10, A.J. Green, number 11, Devonta Freeman, number 12, DeMarco Murray. So those are the first 12 picks of the first round, 2017. Now, I'm going to move into the second round, so 13th pick overall. I got everything written down, boom, bing, bang, boom. Jordan Howard of the Chicago Bears. Now, he averaged over 120 yards from scrimmage this year in only 11 starts. He was the second leading rusher in the NFL, despite getting only 12 carries through the first 3 weeks. So he barely even played the first 3 weeks, but as soon as he got into the starting position for the Chicago Bears, he was an absolute stud. He had the 11th most carries in the NFL, so 10 other guys got more carries than him. He had the second most rushing yards out of any running back in the NFL. So in games where he got double-digit touches, he had at least 90 yards in every single one. So it wasn't a boom or bust guy. He didn't have his really big games and then really shitty games. He was consistent throughout the entire season, something that you need in your RB1. He's a clear workhorse there. From weeks 4 to 17, he was RB6 overall. I know next year going into 2017, there's going to be question marks around him. Can he do it again? You know, like what's going on with that Chicago Bears offense? And if you just look at what he did in 2016, I think he warrants a late first round, early second round pick, to be honest with you. He looked really good last year. He's going to be the clear workhorse there, so I think he's ready to go. And I think he's number 13 pick overall for 2017 fantasy foosball drafts. Number 14, Dallas Cowboys wide out, Dez Bryant. I mean, Dez Bryant, I apologize. Now, he's been around this pick. He's been in like the 8 to 14 range for the last like 4 years consecutively. And I think a lot of his draft position going into 2017 is going to be predicated on how he finished this season, how he finished 2016. He had a really, really big game against the Green Bay Packers. And I think that might leapfrog him into the top 10 as a top 10 pick, which I think would be a big mistake for a lot of people, which is why I have him at 14, not 8, 9, or 10. If you look at that big game, Green Bay was awful against the pass. They have a terrible, terrible pass defense. They've had a terrible pass defense all year, and they got absolutely destroyed by number one receivers. Like, look what happened the next game when they play against Julio Jones. I don't think what Dez did was, I mean, obviously he's an elite talent. He's very impressive, but it's not like no one's done that to Green Bay. He's done that plenty. People have done that plenty of times. I just feel like Dez disappears for games at a time. You know, he had 7 or fewer targets in 7 of 13 games last year. Like, you don't want your number one receiver having 6 targets, 5 targets, 4 targets in more than half of his games. And he had 4 or fewer receptions in 8 of 13 of those games. I know he's an elite talent, and you couple that with the fact that the offense is really good, but he does disappear at times. There'll be plenty of games where he doesn't get his target numbers, and if you don't hit him with a deep shot, which is not his forte, he's not really going to put up those big numbers for you. And I think that offense is, just look at what they did this year with the ground and pound game. The offense is very, very much predicated on that offensive line, and clearly they're going to be feeding Zeke the ball 20 to 25 times going forward, which chews up the clock. I mean, their time of possession is like unfucking worldly because of the way that they run the ball. They're going to be giving him so many carries. It's going to eat the clock. It's going to eat the clock. It's going to eat the clock. I wouldn't be surprised if next year, you know, there's going to be plenty of times going to the third quarter where Dez has one catch for 14 yards, 2 catches for 23 yards, or something like that, and you're kind of hoping on a big play or a big drive from him, and that's not what I want out of my wide receiver one. So, I mean, if you can get a stud as your first pick and then Dez on the way back, I'm not going to be mad at that, but I'm not reaching for Dez in the 8 to 10 range. Definitely wait on him here. Number 15. Probably going to be a little bit of a controversial pick for a lot of you guys. I'm going to move this camera up because the light keeps getting in my freaking eyes when I move up. Number 15, Jay Ajayi. That wasn't right. Jay Ajayi. Now, Jay Ajayi had his big breakout, obviously. He had those 3 games of over 200 rushing yards. And that, you know, that obviously boosted his rushing total, so he ended up as the 4th leading rusher in the NFL. Now, when you have games like that, obviously it's easy to say, oh, all the stats are skewed, you know, those stats by itself made up 60% of his production, and it's easy to write it off and say, hey, those are unlikely to happen again. But I don't think it's as easy as just saying, oh, he had 3 200-yard rushing games. Like, that's not a fluke, you know? Like, that's impressive on its own. Anyone that could rush for 200 yards in a game, let alone 3 fucking times, is talented and has a place in this league and has a place in an offense. So I think more importantly, what you have to do is look at the games outside of those 200-yard rushing games to see what his normal efficiency is really like. Now, he averaged 4.9 yards a carry over the year. When you subtract those 200-yard games, it dips to 3.7 yards per carry. But he does still have a really strong yards after contact, which dips down to 2.7 from his league-leading 3.5. So if you include his big games, he leads the league in yards after contact, 3.5. So he's a muscular, quick, shifty guy with a lot of strength. Now, when you take out those big games, it drops to 2.7 yards after contact. Still a really strong number, so that's a good sign of efficiency. I think going into next year, he's the clear workhorse there in Miami. I think a lot of how he does is going to be predicated on what the coaching staff sees out of him in this offseason and how much they actually trust the guy. So if, you know, if they go in, if you hear reports all offseason, J.J. is our guy, he's our starter, he's our workhorse, I'm not going to be hesitant to draft him. I know he was mediocre outside of his big games, but if you're going to be the workhorse in any offense, I like what he's done. I like his resume. I like those 200-yard rushing games, man. I like that he's going to be the goal line back there in Miami. So I think, again, a lot of it's predicated on what the coaching staff believes they can do with him. There's not a lot of competition outside of him. So, J.J., another featured back, takes the 16th spot, Lamar Miller out of Houston. Signed to that big contract in the offseason. Obviously, he was coming in to be the workhorse there, and it's something that he never really got to do in Miami. I wouldn't go ahead and say that Miller was a bust. He battled some injuries throughout the year, and he had fucking Brock Osweiler behind center. So, I mean, you couple those two things together, It's hard to imagine any running back playing that well. He averaged over 90 yards per scrimmage, 90 yards from scrimmage per game this year, which is obviously a plus. If you're going to give me 9 fantasy points without any touchdowns being factored in, that's not bad. But the big problem, again, was not finding the end zone. He only ended up with 6 total touchdowns on the year. And that's a lot to do with that Texans offense as a whole. They were ranked, I think, 28th overall as a scoring offense, just over 17 points a game. So it's not like they were getting down to the goal line. It's not like they were getting down in the red zone where he could kind of get those touchdown opportunities, you know? So it's not entirely his fault, but that doesn't mean things are going to change next year and all of a sudden, because it was bad this year, it's going to be good next year. I looked up something I wanted to see in terms of his efficiency when he did get down to the red zone. There were 17 running backs that had double-digit carries inside the 5-yard line. Lamar Miller had 11 carries inside the 5-yard line, and he turned 6 of them into touchdowns, which is just under 55% of his carries inside the 5. Of those 17 running backs that got double digits inside the 5, only Latavius Murray, Jonathan Stewart, and Ezekiel Elliott converted a higher percentage of those carries into touchdowns. So it's not like Miller was inefficient. It's not like they got there and he was terrible. You know, like he was not getting the work done. He was not getting the job done. He was performing well when he got there. It just happened that the offense as a whole struggled mightily. So I think going into 2017, there's going to be more red flags around this guy than there actually should be. And I think he could end up being a pretty big value pick if he drops to the later half of the second round. There's no competition there in Houston for him. He is the goal line back. And as I just kind of proved to you guys, he was efficient in being that goal line back. He catches balls. He's very athletic. He's shifty. So he's going to be the 3-down workhorse there. And you'd have to assume that with J.J. Watt back, the defense is going to be a little stronger, which means the offense is going to run through the ground a little more. You know, I think he's just going to go a little undervalued for the amount of opportunities that he's going to get. He averaged over 20 touches a game, so that's something you should probably see again in 2017. Pick number 17. I am going to get a lot of people disagreeing with me on this one. 17 goes to the sophomore wideout in NOLA. New Orleans, Michael Thomas. I said this throughout last preseason that I thought Thomas could fill that void in terms of what Marcus Colston brought to this offense in his prime kind of years. You know, that 1,000 yards, 7 touchdowns. I didn't know it was going to come this quickly, but I was high on Michael Thomas, and I thought he was going to be a great piece to this offense. And he fit that mold for Colston and then some in 2016. He missed the game and he still finished as a top 7 fantasy wide receiver. The dude's 6'2", 6'3", 215 pounds, that very prototypical type number one receiver you look for in a dominant fantasy player. He finished with 92 catches, over 1,130 yards, 9 touchdowns, and he has Drew Brees fucking throwing him the ball. Drew Brees has more 5,000-yard passing seasons, which he did again in 2016, than like every other quarterback who's ever done it combined, basically. So when you have 5,000 yards being accounted for, you know, they have to go to someone. And Thomas is clearly a huge key to this offense, and he's only going to grow as the years go. So there's literally, his floor is so high. His floor is like what he did this year, plus growing into some. Now, when you look at the red zone targets, he led the team in red zone targets. He out-targeted Brandon Cooks 19-11 in the red zone. And only 3 wide receivers in the entire NFL had more targets inside the 10-yard line than Michael Thomas did. That was Jordy Nelson, Davante Adams, and Larry Fitzgerald. Pretty damn good company, if you ask me. Thomas had 11 targets inside the 10. The next closest on the team were Willie Snead, Brandon Cooks, and Travaris Cadet all had 6. So Michael Thomas almost doubled their targets inside the 10. Now, an interesting fact here. Michael Thomas was the only wide receiver in the entire NFL last year to have at least 4 catches and at least 40 yards in every single game he played in last year. Only wide receiver in the NFL to do that. I don't know. I don't know about you, but to me, he looks like a super, 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 super duper safe pick. Maybe his ceiling is not as high as guys like A.J. Green and guys like, you know, like Jordy and Dez Bryant and things like that. But I think his floor is higher, if not the same. He's looking like the real prototypical number one receiver. He was Drew Brees' favorite target going forward into the season. A lot of people thought it'd be Brandon Cooks, but it came out to be Michael Thomas, which is pretty fascinating in my opinion. Going forward, I think Michael Thomas is a great pick, and I think next year around this time we could be looking at him as a top 8 fantasy wide receiver. I mean, top 8 pick overall as a fantasy wide receiver. Brings us to number 18 out in LA, I guess you could say now, Melvin Gordon. After a terrible rookie year in which his mother was embarrassed to wear his jersey, he bounced back. He took an L last night, but he bounced back. Melvin Gordon took Big Sean's lyrics very seriously, so seriously, bounced back in a huge way in 2017, and is going to be one of the most intriguing fantasy players going into 2017. There's going to be thousands of articles written on him, thousands of videos made, thousands of hours of discussion on whether or not he is a fluke, a one-hit wonder. Now, from what I've seen so far, and it's early, it's the end of January, Melvin Gordon is being ranked very high in fantasy circles. I've seen him in the top 5 fantasy running backs going off the board this year, which to me is a little fucking crazy. I know a lot of people will either side with, you know, he was a stud, there's no reason he can't do it again. He had a lot of production, a lot of it was touchdown dependent. Oh, he couldn't do it again because Danny Woodhead is going to be back next year. There's so many variables and so many key factors that are going to be really, really tough to kind of assimilate and really extract an opinion off of all those different variables. And in my opinion, I kind of see a definite dip in numbers. He's not going to be the full feature back there in LA again with Danny Woodhead coming back. Let me read some numbers for you. Now, when you look back, well, first of all, a ton of Gordon's fantasy production came in the red zone, obviously, this year. I mean, it came everywhere because he was the only fucking guy touching the ball, but it's super underrated what Woodhead does in the red zone for this team, what he's done for the last couple of years, so that's going to be a huge factor going into next year. Here's some numbers for you. In 2015, Woodhead saw over 38% of the Chargers' targets inside the 10. Not just running back targets, all wide receivers. 38% of targets inside the 10, which was the fifth most of any NFL player. Wide receivers, tight ends, running backs. Now, when you look at his rushing numbers, he had 71% of the team's rushing attempts inside the 5-yard line, and around the same percentage inside the 10. Now, when you look at Melvin Gordon, he led the NFL in terms of percentage of his team's rushes inside the 5, was second in terms of inside the 10, and was third in the red zone. He had 85% of the Chargers' rushing attempts inside the 5-yard line. That's why he scored so many damn touchdowns. And to me, if you looked at some of the runs he had in which he scored outside of the red zone, you know, those big 30, 40, 50-yard touchdowns that he broke out for a lot this year, he was untouched. It wasn't like he was making a ton of plays. Don't get me wrong, he made a ton of plays this year, and he looked good, but a lot of the big touchdown runs were just unscathed, just big gaps in the line where he didn't get touched, he didn't have to make a guy miss or anything like that. You simply saw a hole, hit it hard. Anyone under 4.5 speed would have been in the end zone. Anyone under 4.6 speed probably would have been in the end zone as well. So those are things that I look at as variables. Like I don't predict that those things are going to happen again. So I think a smart thing to do would be looking at the red zone numbers, like I was just telling you, how Woodhead was such a key piece of the Chargers offense when it came to those numbers. He had a huge year. He still only averaged 3.9 yards per carry. The big uptick in numbers came from red zone rushes, red zone catches, and just receiving overall. He became a much better receiving back, but you just have to be conscious that Danny Woodhead is going to be back, and he's been such a huge part of the red zone. He's been such a huge part of that passing game when he is on the field, so those numbers are both going to dip for Melvin Gordon, which is why I don't see Melvin Gordon as a flat-out RB1. I would be very hesitant to have him as my number one back. So for me, mid to late second round is okay with Melvin. I'd rather get him late and maybe early third round, but I don't know if he's going to drop that far. Leads us to number 19, our boy out in Indy on Apolis. The Colts star wide receiver T. What does he do? He does that, right? T.Y. Hilton. Brought to you by Hilton. Thank you, our sponsor, Hilton, T.Y. Hilton. Both of you guys are our sponsors. Love y'all. Monster, too. I don't know where you're at. I had a Monster before, but we're having a Diet Pepsi now. That was like the Diet Coke and Mentos thing where it fucking blows up. Just have it in my mouth. So, another huge year for T.Y., 91 catches, almost 1,450 receiving yards, which led the NFL and 6 tutties. Now, he finishes the wide receiver 5 in fantasy. You can't doubt the guy's talent, obviously. He's been doing it consistently now, no down years. I think it's his 4th straight year with 1,000 yards receiving, so that's been his floor. But he is yet to eclipse 7 receiving touchdowns. He had 6 this year, he had 5 last year, so that's just a constant. That's not going up at all for him. Obviously, Dante Moncrief's going to be back. Well, maybe he's going to be back and healthy next year for the full year. We don't know, obviously, because there's way too much time before the season starts. But I don't really think that's a conflict, really a conflict of interest there, because it's not like Moncrief dominates the red zone. He dominates inside the 10-yard line. That's not where T.Y. makes his money. He makes those deep catches that really rack up the yards per catch and yards per target and things like that. So that's where his touchdowns come from. That's where his yardage come from. So I'm not really worried about T.Y.'s value when Moncrief is on the field. What concerns me is T.Y.'s production against good teams. When you look back at the 2016 schedule, let me read off some numbers for you here. Now, they played, I would consider these 5 games like good pass defenses. Played at Denver, he was 4 for 41. At Houston, he was 3 for 49. Against KC, 1 for 20. Home against Pittsburgh, 3 for 54. And at Minnesota, 3 for 45. Those are some of the top pass defenses in the league, and he struggled against them. So he dominated against the shitty teams, which of course you always want. But you need your elite wide receiver ones to be able to dominate against good teams as well. And I think that's why T.Y. does drop down to this middling 8, and he's floated around here for the last 3 years, I would say, around this fantasy pick, and he led the NFL in receiving yards last year. How many times does a receiver lead the NFL in receiving yards and then still come back as almost around the same ADP? You know what I mean? So people are smart. They know some good things out of the season. He had 9 targets in 12 of the 16 games. He went over 90 yards in 8 of them. 2 of those games were over 170 yards. So he has a good ceiling. He is that deep threat, and he is getting a ton of targets, regardless of where they are, regardless of who they're against. The volume is there. But there definitely are red flags. They have a pretty tough division. He's got to go against Houston twice, who always has a good pass D, and they're going to have to see the Jaguars twice, who Jalen Ramsey is that emerging stud cornerback rookie. So I'm not going to base all my picking of T.Y. Hilton on just that fact, but that is something that drags him down a little bit. Number 20. This is a good one.
What's up? Since we're on the cover of Todd Gurley, sorry, my camera died. Now I just want to flex on y'all.
Sorry, that was so dumb. Okay, so next up, number 20 was Todd Gurley. Already anointed the next Trent Richardson, huh? I'm here to say, pump the brakes. We like to move it. Pump them before we get all crazy and call Todd Gurley next T-Rich. T-Rich, T-Raw. Yeah, I get it. He was fucking terrible last year. He was really, 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 really bad. And a lot of you guys wasted a top 5, top 7 pick on his ass, which probably lost you a season if you did so. Maybe not. If you're good on the wire. But he was bad. He didn't get over 100 yards rushing in a single game. 3.2 yards per carry. But there is good news. He doubled his catch total. So he is becoming their receiving back. He averaged over 20 touches per game last year. Home. And there's no fucking way the Rams are bringing in another running back to take any of the work from Gurley. They will ride him until he dies just based off his rookie year. The Rams organization is just a sad organization right now. I'm surprised they got rid of Jeff Fisher, but thank God they did so. They will not cut their losses on Gurley, even if he performs. He could average 1.1 yards per carry last year, and I'm pretty sure he'd still be their feature back. So I'm not worried about any competition coming in. He is their 3-down back. We've seen his potential. We've seen what he did in 2015. And I think all the noise that he's going to hear throughout this offseason about how fucking terrible he was and how bad he was. You know, when good players hear that stuff, that's motivation, man. That is like, that's something, that's an X factor. It's something you can't put on paper, obviously, until the final stats are in for next year. But I guarantee you, I don't want to be talking about like emotional intelligence when we're talking about fantasy football, but if you're Gurley and all people are doing is talking shit all offseason,
That's got to be huge motivation for you to really fucking put that work in this offseason, watch the film, see where you went wrong, and improve on a ton of shit. You know, they're obviously going to have to improve through the draft. Hopefully they get some linemen to protect Jared Goff's ass and protect Gurley from behind the line hits. That's a whole nother thing. My whole thing with Gurley is they're not going to bring competition in. He is the receiving back as well as the goal line, the red zone, the fucking between the 20s back. And anytime you can get a back like this, a fully featured 20-touch-a-game back for a third-round price or a late second-round price, you could do a lot worse. Which seems to be kind of the notion of a lot of running backs this year within the first couple rounds. It's there, the feature back. But, you know, it's a real thing. A volume is key. Volume is king when it comes to fantasy football. And it's not like, I mean, I don't want to say it's not like, he probably lost you a fucking season, but he didn't lose you individual games. He did score double-digit fantasy points in 9 of the 16 games. And two of the other games, he scored like 9.7 and 9.4. So he was like above 9 points in 11 of the 16 games. So that's not a number that's going to kill you. But obviously when you use your first round pick on a guy, you want to see that 13 to 15 points per game kind of range. So obviously that's where it hurts you. But yeah, I know I'm probably, this might be an unpopular opinion, but I'm okay with Gurley as my, I don't want to say RB1, but it, you know, if it comes down to that, if I get two stud wide receivers and Gurley's my RB1, I'm not going to kill myself over it. Which brings us to numero 21. I'm actually thinking about this because this is a guy, Mark Ingram. It's Mark Ingram. I'm not going to keep the suspense going, but I'm actually debating with myself whether I would take Mark Ingram or Todd Gurley first. And that's a tight one, but I'm going Mark Ingram here, number 21. You know, despite all the negativity, there's a lot of red flags last year. You know, he was benched. He split all this time with Tim Hightower. He still finished as a top 10 running back in fantasy. Actually, he was number 10 in standard and number 8 in PPR. He averaged 5.1 yards per carry, which is 4th best in the NFL. That's a gorgeous number for any running back. And he also averaged 3.1 yards after contact, which is 4th in the NFL. So in terms of efficiency, he was a fucking beast. He had 10 total touchdowns, over 1,350 scrimmage yards. He had 46 receptions, so he's back-to-back years of at least that, if not more. Last year, he had over 50. And he just turned 27, or he's just turned, let me see. He just turned 27, so he's still in the prime of his running back career. A lot of people are going to say, Tim Hightower took over a key role there. And to that, I would say, look at the end of the season. Look how they finished the season to see what the coaching staff thinks about that. Ingram ended the season with 19, 20, and 26 touches over the last 3 weeks of the season, which put him as fantasy running back 3 over that span. Not a big sample size, but I'm saying the number of touches he got over the last few games is pretty telling of how the coaching staff felt. Now, in that same span in which he had 19, 20, 26, Tim Hightower finished with 14, then 9, then 3. So you could see the touch discrepancy going down the stretch. The big thing here was the carries inside the 5-yard line. Ingram only got 7 carries inside the 5, which was 29% of the team's total carries. Hightower got 10, so he was out-touched 7-10. Hightower scored on 4 of 10. Ingram scored on 2 of 7. Neither a great percentage, but you could see the volume that Hightower got was obviously higher than Ingram. We can all count here. 10 is higher than 7. Now, I think the key thing to take away here is Hightower is a serious threat to Ingram's RB1 workload, but he's not a serious threat to actually overtake Ingram as a starter in New Orleans. So even with Hightower getting touches, Ingram is still super efficient, still catches balls, and he's still the clear-cut number one there. So I'm not scared taking Ingram at this pick at all. Number 22, the man out of San Francisco, Carlos Hyde. Number 22 pick, the running back for the 49ers. Let's see. He only played in 13 games, but he was a top 10 running back in terms of fantasy points per game. So when he's in there, he's good. So he averaged 4.6 yards per carry, 3.1 yards after contact, which was tied for 4th in the NFL on both accounts. Really good numbers from him. Really good to see from when he's healthy. Obviously, that's the big thing here. If he stays healthy, there's no reason why he wouldn't be a top 10 pick, a top 15 pick in terms of fantasy. But he's obviously had injuries his rookie year. He had injuries last year. The key thing here is how good he is when he is playing and how much volume he gets when he does play. He didn't have less than 13 carries in a single game when he did play last year. He looked really good against really stiff competition. So his biggest games came against these guys.
Seahawks, the Rams twice, Arizona, and the New York Jets. All very good rush defenses. He averaged 21 fantasy points per game in those five matchups. I think that's the takeaway here. I think the takeaway here is if you want to get risky, he's a great pick. Obviously, you're scared about his injury, but his efficiency when he's healthy and when he's on the field can't be argued with. Number 23. I know this is going to be a huge discussion all offseason. D-Hop, Allen Robinson, D-Hop. I'm going DeAndre Hopkins here. And he was widely regarded as a top five pick last year going into the year. My top five busts, or was it, I don't know if it was top three or top five, but I had DeAndre Hopkins listed on my bust video last year. He just couldn't overcome Osweiler's terrible, terrible play. When you look at his red zone numbers, he had less targets than Andrew Hawkins, than Chris Conley, and Nelson Aguilar. He had less red zone targets than all three of those guys. That's not a fucking recipe for success when you're a fantasy wide receiver and you're 6'3" and you could jump 59 inches in the air. Throw a goddamn ball to him in the red zone. Jesus Christ, Brock Osweiler. He was 6th in the NFL in targets, and he finished as wide receiver 17. Not a good equation. Now, there's not a lot I can promote on D-Hop going into next year. He's going to be stuck with Osweiler. If it's not Osweiler, it's got to be someone on par with him, if not worse. The only thing I could say is we've seen him put elite production up with a quarterback with a combination of Ryan Mallett and a combination of Brian Hoyer. So, you know what? He's produced with shitty quarterbacks. He only had 3 games under 8.5 fantasy points this year. So, again, he didn't ruin your season. He didn't ruin any particular games probably for you, but he might have fucked your season up because of where you picked him. Didn't finish the season strong. His 2 playoff games, he combined for 30 fantasy points. So, he ended the year on a good note, which is obviously always good going into the next season. Yeah, I'm going D-Hop here. I don't know why. I don't really have a good reason for you, to be honest. Number 24. One you'll probably find very, 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 very interesting here. The man, Adrian Peterson. Peterson. Who knows where he's going to end up next year? Could be the Vikings. He has said that he wouldn't mind ending up with the Bucks, the Texans, or the Giants. Now, before we even get into his prospects next year, you have to fucking look at what's realistic. He's owed $18 million from the Vikings next year. That shit ain't gonna happen. He's only staying in Minnesota if he decides to take a big-ass pay cut. $18 million is ridiculous. You can give $18 million to maybe Le'Veon Bell, and that's about the only back in the NFL you can give that to. Now, he named those 3 teams. You look at the Giants, they play a very shotgun-heavy offense, something that Peterson is not good at running out of. Then you look at the Texans, they just signed Lamar Miller to a fat contract. Why the fuck would he ever go there? That was a dumb statement by Peterson. Then you look at the Bucks. Very, 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 very interesting. The Bucks. Famous Jameis and Adrian Peterson playing together could be a good fit. They have Doug Martin, obviously, but Doug Martin imploded last year. He failed the drug test. He's already out 3 games. And in that failed drug test, it voided any guaranteed money that would have been going to him from the Bucks. So the Bucks could actually eliminate him scot-free. No money to be paid. All the beat reporters out of Tampa Bay are saying that they don't see Martin as a piece of the Bucks offense going forward, short term or long term. So they cut him, wouldn't be surprised, take on Peterson. If there's any place he's gonna end up, I would say it's either Minnesota or the Bucks. And if you look at the Bucks division, they have the Falcons, they have the Panthers, they have the Saints, all terrible run defenses. I mean, the Falcons aren't terrible run defense, but the other two are pretty bad. So I think either of those would be a very good landing spot. I mean, in Minnesota, no matter where he goes, he's gonna be a 20 carry guy. He's going to be fine. I mean, he's coming off his second knee injury, kind of. I mean, he already came back last year. He's Adrian Peterson, and he'll be back to form by the beginning of next season. So it's very hard to pick against him. So I wouldn't be surprised if by the season's start, he was a higher pick than number 24. But that's where I'd go as of right now. I like Peterson. And that's going to wrap up the second round of this mock draft. Just to run through it, we had number 13, Jordan Howard. Number 14, Dez Bryant. Number 15, Jay Ajayi. Number 16, Lamar Miller. 17, Michael Thomas. 18, Melvin Gordon. 19, T.Y. Hilton. 20, Todd Gurley. 21, Mark Ingram. 22, Carlos Hyde. 23, DeAndre Hopkins. 24, Adrian Peterson. Now, that is round dose.
Again, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. Subscribe to the channel if you're already not subscribed. Share this. It helps me get exposure and thus motivating me and thus putting out more videos, bro. So do all that shit. Again, follow me on all my social medias. Will be linked below. And again, I do a write-up on all my videos, which is on my website, bdgeat.com, linked in the description. I do a write-up, so if you don't want to listen to this bullshit, you can just go read about it. And let me know about the whole podcast thing I mentioned earlier in the video. Would you rather just be a podcast? Would you rather have both options? Am I going to be wasting my time if I start uploading podcasts? So please let me know, give me some feedback, and thank you guys for coming and wasting your time with me. You could be wasting your time anywhere in the world, but you decided to waste it with me. Thank you, and I will see y'all in the next video.
It's ASAP cute with a bread at. Fuck around and bring the hush puppies back. She fucked me and a homie, she was cool with that. The black hat, so I'm shedding in my bucket hat. Pause a little bit, I got a little advice. If you fucked her once, then you can fuck her twice. And don't get hair from hoes with overbites. Just giving out game, nigga, show you right. Born son, a nigga, turn night to bright. High as a kite in my Nike flights. Made 30 racks, it was just a flight. For a bitch out, too, it was just a night.